I'm going to be very brief because I'm only going to tell you how we're going on 7 o'clock. I'm going to just paint the European standards against which the things that have been explained to you in technical terms should be judged with a bit of criticism. So as you can see, we've got Article 8 of the European Convention on the Rights of Technical Privacy. We've got general European EU law, with certain problems in it. We've got the Charter of Fundamental Rights, CFR is a bit less known here than the ECHR, and we've got the European Data Protection Law. There's Article 8. Article 8 is old-fashioned. It was drafted, of course, in the 1950s, so we talk about communications, but about correspondence, but the court has been kind enough to interpret that broadly and cover all sorts of communications. What I want to point out is it doesn't make any distinction between contents and metadata, right? Covers communication. Second point, look at these words, law and necessary, and I'll tell you what that means. I think you probably most already know. Our claim is a typical convention right. It's structured in two ways. The right to find person and explain that the states can make interferences with the right. So the question is, when you interfere with private right, looking at any kind of aspect of communication interference with private life, has to be based on law. And the word law has to be written in biggest letters you can possibly find. Right? Protection of the rule of law is the underpinning principle of the European Convention on Human Rights. And law is not just any legal rule that the state feels like drawing up. It is a legal rule that is binding. I want to stress that, because the UK is a tendency to try and use sort of voluntary rules, that's not a law. I'll come back to that. It has to be accessible. It was a prisoner who was, yeah, his correspondence interfered with the rules and wasn't allowed to see him as a violation of the Convention, that we case. It has to be clear, precise, and foreseeable. And many of the things that Peter explained, if he doesn't know how it should work, I wonder how we as a citizen know, not as being surveilled by the world, must serve a legitimate purpose. Security and sort of crime. It must be necessary, and that includes it must be proportionate, which means that the interference and the depth of the intrusion has to be proportionate to the threat or to the seriousness of the issue that's being protected. Simple as that. And most importantly, it also applies to national security. Right? There is an exception in Article 15, derogation of times of war, but as far as I understand, it is not being invoked by the UK government, and I don't know how they will apply it. The ECHR is part of EU law. It's a long list of cases, and I will not go into the background, but very gladly give you a mini lecture on them if you want to. But there is one problem that relies on EU law, and that is the complete exclusion of anything to do with national security from the EU legal framework. I have no idea what that means.
Yeah.
Because there are a whole lot of things that happen within areas that are covered by EU law, covered by the e-privacy directive, by the General Data Protection Directive, and by the Data Retention Directive, that clearly are within EU law. But it says that one of the purposes for these rules is to allow use of certain data under certain circumstances for national security. Does that mean that the state can bypass that or not? I would say not, but this is the Charter of Fundamental Rights. As you can see, it's slightly updated. It uses the word communication instead of correspondence, as in the convention. And it also has a more specific right to protection of personal data. Article 8. Under the European Convention on Human Rights, data protection has to be read into Article 8. Under the Charter of Fundamental Rights, it's given its own sui generis status. There's also an exception clause, not a derogation clause, very similar to the second paragraph of Article 8. States are allowed to interfere with these rights to privacy and private life, but they have to do it on the basis of law, it has to be served with legitimate purpose, and it has to be necessary in proportion to those rights. Simple as that. But, of course, the UK didn't like the CFR, so it got itself an opt-out. And then, again, one that I have no idea what it means. The Charter does not expand the ability of the Court of Justice or any court of tribunal in the United Kingdom to find that the laws, regulations, or ministerial provisions and practices are inconsistent with the fundamental rights that it affirms. But, in other words, the thing has no legal value in English law. Square. Try to get out of Article 8 of the Convention, and legally they can't. The other problem is that we'll find there might be difficulties in trying to enforce some of these rights in Luxembourg rather than in Strasbourg. We're trying about straightforward enforcement of the matters that are covered by EU, so I don't see how we can get out. Now, very, very simple. Personal data must be collected to specify explicit and legitimate purposes, and any further processing is compatible with those purposes. And personal data shall not be kept for longer in identifiable form that is necessary for that purpose. So, if you want to depart from this, in other words, if you want to retain data, if you want ISPs, the telecom service providers, to retain data for longer than they would normally retain for their own personal purposes, that is an interference with the fundamental right as the basic law that has to be circulated in the process of reporting the fundamental right. And then you get to the e-privacy directive, and this is an important one. Member states shall ensure confidential access to communications and the related traffic data. Watch out, it doesn't say content and metadata, it's talking about communications and related traffic data. And it shall prevent technical storage. There's an exception, which is the data retention directive, of course, which is not implemented by the data retention regulations. But if you look at it closely, this is nice and close. It is impossible to read. If you do read it, as I've tried to do, you will see that it really is only metadata, especially in the light of the following, which I think is really important in it. No data revealing the content of the communication may be retained pursuant to this directive. Now, one thing is clear: the people that drafted this had not invited Peter over to tell them they were in advance of this. Because, as Peter says, and as I think Ross says, and many other geeks say, you cannot make the distinction very clearly between traffic data on the one hand and communications on the other. But what you can say is that the retaining of data and the providing allowing of access to data for law enforcement and national security purposes constitutes an interference. And we took a recent, very recent cases in Luxembourg, the Scarlet case and the Lettenberg case, and I'll mention the Bonnier case that came out today. I've just been looking at my emails and just got some information on. This was about states wanting to order ISPs to monitor all internet use in order to be able to detect people who might be unlawfully sharing files, right? For the purpose of protecting the rights of intellectual property rights holders. And the court, in both these cases, said very clearly that this is not allowed. Preventive, indiscriminate, long-term, suspicionless, mass monitoring of all internet activity of all of our ISP subscribers to detect possible breaches of IP rights is a disproportionate interference with the privacy of users. It's a very, very important principle. Now, that is about the protection of rights holders, copyright holders. But of course the same principle applies when you talk about law enforcement and national security. Since you're always talking about the balance, you can't have a balance with all the weight put on one side and no weight at all on the other side. It may be easier to justify widespread surveillance for law enforcement and national security purposes, but you must strike a balance. So I think no, you cannot have suspicionless mass preventive surveillance of everybody, just like Shelby said. That is turning the world upside down into all its respects. So this is my assessment. And I'll go into time into it later, but perhaps I'll have to wait until a question. The proposed UK rules clearly go against basic data privacy principles. They're quite clear. They demand retention of all sorts of data. They even go behind and beyond the data retention requirement. And that is important. If they're based on voluntary commitments, which is what the UK government likes to do, then that is not law, that is itself a violation of the European Convention of Human Rights. And irrespective of the point of hand that they tried to get with a charter of fundamental rights, it would still be a violation of Article 8 of the European Convention of Human Rights. Let me add one thing that came into my mind in the course of the discussion. I think if you want to assess this balance, which is at the heart of these convention rights, then the issue is not a technical distinction between traffic data and contents data, but how intrusive are the data? So whether you stop the URL after the slash Google or after a later slash depends on how intrusive it is. If you get a complete Google query, I find that extremely intrusive. Look for anything, from porn to abortion, from Al-Qaeda to bombs or whatever. It is extremely intrusive. And therefore, I don't care whether it's traffic data or communication data. In terms of Article 8 of the Convention, it is a serious interference that only can only be justified by extremely high level of public interest. And that must be targeted to a specific suspect. Starting to have extremely intrusive surveillance over everybody without any suspicion is massively in violation of the most fundamental aspects of the Convention. Thank you.